So, let's start. Welcome to my talk, WebAssembly Disentangle. My name is Andreas Haas. I'm a member of the V8 team here in Munich, and yeah, I work on WebAssembly. So some projects of mine were, for example, streaming compilation and parallel compilation to get the improved startup time of WebAssembly. So yeah, in the last talk, Stefan told us about how we get to WebAssembly code, how we can get this .wasm file. He also talked a bit about the code that the .wasm file contains. So my talk will now focus on what else is in such a .wasm file. I will give you an overview. I will not be precise to the bit level. So for that, please take a look at the specification. But I think it's still very interesting what is contained in a module. For example, Stefan mentioned the table section. He mentioned the type section. So yeah, I will now make a step-by-step introduction, starting from kind of JavaScript code, and then show where the different parts come in. So first, Stefan talked about that Inscripten gives you some glue code that instantiates WebAssembly code. Other compilers do something different. But this is more or less the code that is like that all this glue code has to contain somehow. So the first line is more or less that we have to fetch the WASM file. That was the reason why you had to start up the web server. Then we put, so fetch gives you a promise. Then we put the promise into instantiate streaming, which will instantiate our WebAssembly code. And then we can call functions on this WebAssembly instance with instance.export, for example, Fibonacci. Now, okay, we have this call, instance exports Fibonacci. So where does this function come from? So, okay, we assume that there is code because that's what Stefan was talking about. So there should be some code, but the code is just in a binary format. And actually it's like one function after another, just the bytecode. So it does not say anything about the function name Fibonacci. But for this, there is an export section. And the export section actually says, please export with the name Fibonacci a function. And which function? It's the function with index 2. So I assume that there are at least three functions at the moment. And the function with index 2 will be the one that is called with this Fibonacci, with the name Fibonacci. Now the question is, okay, we only say export function 2 with the name Fibonacci, but how do we actually call this function? Okay, the example says we can call it with 42, which is a number, which is, okay, WebAssembly only works on numbers. But what about if we call it with three JavaScript objects, A, B, and C, for example? The cool, nice thing is, so it more or less, really informally, you can read the JavaScript standard of what this all does. In essence, if you have plain JavaScript, it will call the value of function of the objects and then pass these, the result to WebAssembly if it's a number, or otherwise throw a type error. Now, this one time we call it with one parameter, now we call it with three parameters. So in essence, what is happening is that parameters that are not needed will just be dropped. And if there are parameters missing, then we just fill it up with zero, more or less. So it's different to JavaScript that it is does not pass undefined, because WebAssembly does not know undefined. But it also just drops unneeded parameters, and yeah. So you can just call
the Fibonacci function like any other JavaScript function. Yeah?
I guess there was some debate of drawing an exception there.
That's a question that is better asked later. So now the question is, how many parameters will actually go into the WebAssembly function? Because C++ code only accepts a fixed number of parameters and not arbitrary numbers of parameters. So for this, we now have the type section, which Stefan already showed. There was this type 19 thingy. And the type section is now more or less a list of signatures. And each signature has the form first number of parameters and then the types of the parameters. For example, here we have two parameters, one of type int32, one of type float32. And then it has one return of type int32. So just as some background, WebAssembly has four types, which is integer and float in 32 bits and 64 bits. At the moment, the number of returns is restricted to 1 or 0, but there is a proposal to extend this number, to be also able to return 57 parameters if you want. So now, this only says there is this signature. Now we also need the function section, which maps functions to signatures. So for example, this would be the content of the function section. So we have first the number of functions, and then we say the first function has signature 2, second function is signature 1, third function is signature 0, fourth function is signature 2. Yes?
One question, can I pass arrays?
Well, no.
No.
It says just these four values, yeah. You have to work around these. So there are ways to pass arrays, but not directly. Yeah. So now, next point. How can we call from WebAssembly to JavaScript? So Stefan already brought up the example that like printing a string to a console, this has to be done in JavaScript somehow. WebAssembly does not support it directly because it's more than two types and yeah. So this is provided by the embedder. The embedder is implemented in JavaScript at the moment. So how can we call from WebAssembly to JavaScript? So for this, we have an import section where we say first we pass two strings which define the import for the embedder, and we define the type of the import. And then we have to extend the call to instantiate by providing a second object with here's the first string. And the second string, and then provide a value, which is, for example, this function f. And then the WebAssembly call can just call internally to this imported function. So from the inside, from the WebAssembly code, it looks exactly the same. It would be a call to function 0, which would be the imported function. Now, we could have we could instantiate it a second time with a different function with different number of parameters. Then it's like calling a JavaScript function. It will, first of all, imports also have a signature. So this means from the inside, we know how many parameters we want to pass to this function and what we get in return. So if the JavaScript function does not match, then we will either drop some parameters or we will add additional parameters, which will in this case be undefined. Simple, because from the JavaScript point of view, it's like a normal JavaScript call. And from the WebAssembly point of view, it will be more or less a normal WebAssembly call. So there is a wrapper in between which matches everything. Next question, how can we call from WebAssembly to WebAssembly? Well, we saw that we can import functions. So we can also just import a WebAssembly function. So in the case of a WebAssembly function, we have the restriction that the signatures have to match, because we have a fixed signature for the imported function, and one that we expect, so we can make a comparison. But then if we have this signature match, we can do calls which are more or less as fast as internal calls. Now, next question is, how can we call back? Because, okay, I can import the function from this instance when I instantiate this instance, but not the other way around. I mean, there's an order. So for this, we again have this the WebAssembly table. So Stefan introduced it as a way to store functions as data, so to say. But it's also used to allow multiple instances to call between each other, no matter in which order you instantiate them. So now again, we have our example WebAssembly file. So in this file, we can define a table which has a type which is at the moment always anyfunc, which means it can store functions. There is a flag which says, so tables can grow. So the question is there an upper limit, how far it can grow or not? So this is the second flag. The third, the number 10, is the initial size of the table. And the last one is the maximum size, because I said it has a maximum, so I have to specify a maximum size. And then I want to initialize the table. So there is the element section, where it says, at index 3, enter function 5, at index 4, enter function 17, and so on. So it's more or less a list of functions that should be entered at this location, in a special encoding. Well, and then, similar to functions, we can also export tables. And it's the same as before. We specify a name. This time we say that it is a table, and it is the table with index 0, which is at the moment always the case because there exists exactly one table. But it can be extended in the future. Yeah, and then I can get the table with instance.export, the name I specified, which is my type. So, how do I use it now? From a second WebAssembly instance? Well, I say in the import section that I want to import a table with this name. So, and again, it does not matter where the table comes from, I can still initialize the table with elements as before. Yeah, and then I can, let's say I have the first instance, I have the table, then I can just fetch the second WASM module and instantiate it and provide the inputs again as before, but this time I don't provide a function, but I provide a table. But other than that, it's the same. Now, tables can also contain JavaScript functions, does not matter. As Stefan also said, calls to tables are slower because we have to check at runtime if the signature matches. We cannot just call any JavaScript function, any WebAssembly function, but only WebAssembly functions that that have a matching signature. So yeah, otherwise there will be a trap.
Is it easy to say what's expensive in checking the signature? Why is it just not five jumps and it check
Say again?
What's expensive in checking the signature?
No, it's more expensive than a direct call. It's just that you have
But just a few instructions.
Anyway. Yeah.
Okay.
I mean, it's not the end of the world, but it's not as fast.
So there's no chance for inlining?
Yes. Well, you can do the JavaScript approach and do like you inline and then do a de-optimization step where you say if it still matches, then you use the inline code and otherwise you de-optimize. But we don't do that at the moment. So I said at the moment there exists only one table, so there is a proposal to allow multiple tables and then also to allow JavaScript objects to be stored in these tables. So this is the AnyRef proposal that I'm working on right now. Yeah, and that would allow multiple tables and that JavaScript objects can be stored in tables and also that JavaScript objects can be passed to WebAssembly and then either be returned or stored in the table more or less.
Does the WebAssembly spec already reference the JavaScript spec?
Yes.
Okay. So this would
actually
closer.
So for the AnyRef, no. Actually not. For the AnyRef, so there is the core specification which is independent and then there is the JS API specification which more naturally links to the JavaScript specification. And for AnyRef, it's more or less just an opaque type. So it's something that WebAssembly doesn't know about, that it can store into the table, or which it can pass around as parameters or return.
So but it would be specified in the JS API?
In the JS API, it's then specified that this can be any object.
Okay.
So, okay, this is more or less everything about function calls. Now I will wrap it up with the other things that are mentioned in the module. So the first thing is the memory. So similar to the table section, we can say it has a maximum size or not. And then we can define an initial size, which is, in this case, 10 pages of 64 kilobytes. And we can define a maximum size. Then there is a data section in this case, which allows it to, where we can initialize the memory. And because the data section could be really big, it's put at the end after the code. So the code itself, so the header sections, they are all really small and they are often used to compile the code. But for example, for streaming compilation, we want the code to be loaded as quickly as possible so that we can start compiling already the code. And the data is typically not needed for compiling the code. Yeah, then again, we can export the memory so that we can import it in other modules. And yeah, so instead of defining our own memory, we can just import the memory of some other vessel module. And then we can again initialize that memory with our own data section. So it can be that each instance has its separate part of the memory, and then it initializes its part.
When does this happen? This matching, this binding of separate, you know, what is that, tables and, or memory parts? Is there some sort of linker step or
yeah.
something
so
like
this,
that?
Yeah, so this, I mean, matching instances have, matching .wasm files have to be provided,
mm-hmm.
so that they fit together. Yeah, this is a, yeah, link. But the final combination can then be done in the web page.
Okay.
So there are some tricks, so for example, the addresses where the data should be put can be provided by a global variable that can be passed from the outside. So you could pass different global variables to the instance so that you say, here start at this address, this instance start at this address, the other instance starts at another address. So, okay, then there are some remaining sections which would be global variables, so WebAssembly has global variables. They have a type. Then you can define if they can be changed or not inside the module, inside the instance, and an initial value. globals can also be exported, but at the moment only immutable globals can be exported. And they can also be imported. But because only immutable globals can be exported, they also only immutable globals can be imported. And there is a start function, which is executed at the end of instantiation. Now, one small question for the end. Do we actually need a code section? In principle, no. We can just import a function. Naturally, we have to define the type, the signature of the function, and the function section so that we do the mapping, because that's needed for any import. And then we can just export this function again. And so if we instantiate this version file, for example, with console.log, then we can just call instance.export.print, so print we have defined here. And it will, with any value, and then it will print that value. So it's more or less actually just an assignment of console.log to export print. So it's called like a normal JavaScript function. No wrappers or anything. That was it.
What's the maximum memory limit for the last memory?
4 gigabytes. So at the moment, memory is addressed with 32-bit integers. So that's the limit.
I tried to allocate more than 2 gig, so it's crashing.
That's a browsing post limit. So because internally there are mechanisms that don't allow bigger memory.
So the technique practically is 2 gig in browser.
Yeah.
So the 2 gigs is intentionally by the browsers to prevent bad actors hijacking your computer.
Okay.
Not hijacking but making it slow.
Yeah. Makes sense.
Thanks.
Is there a way to somehow call a function with a string?
Say again?
To call a function with a string argument. There's no direct way, but is there a way to work around this?
Sure, you put the string into a WebAssembly array, you pass in the array index, you pass it to WebAssembly, and the WebAssembly function will eventually pass it back.
Okay, cool.
Or you can... So as I said, WebAssembly memory can be exported and it can actually also be accessed from JavaScript. So you can write directly into the memory at some index and use whatever string encoding, and then you can also load it back out of it.
Yeah. Is streaming execution on the horizon?
What do you mean?
So you start compiling and then like you make some of the functions available as they are compiled, not as the whole module is compiled. Or does this start section make that impossible?
I think it would make it. Well, I guess if it's also part of the functions that can be executed immediately. But it would more or less mean that you're not allowed to access the memory because it's not initialized yet.
Only get the instance after completing compilation.
But you download parts of the instance that are needed for the for the function you're trying to execute, or is the granularity that's supposed to be on like a module level, that like modules are small and you stream them very quickly and you execute them?
Well, so one thing is that the memory will not be initialized because the data section comes after the functions. So if that's
okay.
So in that sense, and with fast enough compilation will always be finished before the data section is processed completely. So that if it runs perfectly, you would not have this situation. If you really want it, you can split the the WASM files and do like the small starter part into one instance, which can then already execute. Mm-hmm. And everything that this thing produces, you import into the other one. And then, yeah, run the rest in the second instance. Yeah?
Can we have some kind of lazy compilation and compile only when we need some function, when we execute it from export, as we have in JavaScript?
So the problem with lazy compilation is that it doesn't provide predictable execution time. Because you hit some code path that is not compiled, and then it takes long.
So it's compiled ahead of time.
Yeah.
Everything in the one module is compiled ahead of time.
Yeah.
I think there are two levels of compilers in some browsers. They're experimenting with a baseline compiler that is later on, like in JavaScript, then optimized. But this is not done in every browser currently. I think Edge is experimenting with something like this.
It's not even experimenting. So Clemens here is actually working on a baseline compiler for...
No, he was talking of Edge.
Yeah, sure. So, but in the browsers, we are not experimenting.
No, we are launching.
Firefox already has that, and we are launching it in 69, at least the first slice of it. Clemens probably can talk more about that.
Together with streaming compilation, it's then like we compile really fast, and we hope that the startup time is more or less acceptable, at least.
But usually you expect the WASM binaries already to be optimized, I think, right? Because they're compiled basically from a higher level language to the binaries, and there you already have several levels of optimization.
Yeah, but that's only for LLVM, so or for EnScripten, where we expect the WASM code to be optimized. So it's not, it's true that this will be the case for many WASM files, but we don't have this assumption typically.
Do you have a way to combine modules afterwards? I mean, if you have several modules that you are working together quite often?
Well, you can. So you can combine them with imports. You can combine them with tables. And you can also share the memory.
Yeah, I mean, combining in a way that you can optimize these and not have the whole indirect calls, if they are always working together.
Well, that's something that the embedder can always do that. So we don't do that at the moment. But if this is a pattern that will show up regularly, then well, you can use this JavaScript approach of really inline or inline indirect calls or table calls, and then just check does it still match, and otherwise de-optimize. Yeah.
I have a question about tables.
Okay.
And for example, one module export table.
Yeah.
Elements and these elements and other module calls indirect this table.
Yeah.
But how it could know the correct index for call indirect to this table in another module?
Mm.
Which was exported. How?
Well, it can be provided as a parameter. It can be stored in a, like it can be provided, like the WebAssembly code is called somehow from the embedder, from JavaScript, for example. So this, the index can be passed as a parameter. So this is more or less part of the glue code. You can, like it's, you have to fix this problem somehow, but there are ways to fix it.
It's okay, and who's, like in a ideal world, who is the, which tool has to do with this problem? Slinker, or compiler, or developer?
I would guess a linker would do that somehow. Thanks for your attention.